Luke chapter 22 and verse number 19 tells us that when we celebrate the Lord's Supper, and by the way, we're going to do that two Sundays from now. We're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper. But when we do that, he tells us that we're to remember, right? It says that he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In other words, we're to remember what Christ did for us on the cross. We're to remember all of the blessings. I wonder, is there anybody here today who can say, "I can remember back to the day I gave my life to Christ"? You remember that day? I can. I was just a young boy. I was about 5 years old, and my dad was a pastor, and we were having a tent meeting, believe it or not. Sawdust was on the floor. I don't remember what the preacher preached. I don't remember any of that. But you know what I remember is the feeling in my heart, like I needed to go forward, and I went forward, and I accepted Jesus Christ into my life. I'm so grateful for that day. Come on. Do you remember what God has done for you? Is there anybody that can look back and say, "You know, I remember when I was going through that difficult moment, that difficult hour in my life, and I cried out to the Lord, and I called out on him, and all of a sudden I was laying there in bed, and the tears were running down my cheeks, and yes, I knew that things were tough, but I also knew that there was a God who was real, and he was with me." Come on, somebody. I'm just here today to tell you that we've got to understand that if we're going to build family memories in our life, let's start with building the family memories about the spiritual things that God has done. Let's start with building family memories about all of the blessings of the Lord. It's important when you sit around the table, when you're in the car, when you're going out to eat, wherever you are at, to weave in your testimony and talk about what the Lord has done. And maybe he kept you from going out into deep sin. That's a wonderful testimony. Come on. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise for that. Amen. Or maybe you didn't know Christ and you were from a family that didn't know the Lord and you just were all out there entangled. But you know what? Jesus came along and set you free. Those things need to be said over and over and over again to your family, to your grandkids. And if you live long enough, to your great-grandkids. Amen. Amen. Psalms 145 and verse 4 is one of my favorite verses. I love this verse. It says this: "One generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts." What I'm saying today is don't depend upon the pastor to be the one to do that, right? This isn't talking about what the pastor does on Sunday morning. No, this is talking about what we are supposed to do in our families and in our homes, to talk about the good things that God has done. Amen. Tell of the heritage that God has given. Amen. You heard me say so many times about how God healed my son Derek of stuttering. I'm going to constantly tell that story everywhere I go, all the time. Why? Because it's a dramatic, instantaneous, overnight healing story of the power of God. I couldn't have done that. No, the one who did that was my God. I prayed, I called, he answered. Hello. Amen. And those kind of stories can be in our life. Amen. Those kind of stories. And I wonder, can you identify this morning some of those stories? Some of them need to be told from our grandparents' perspective, right? Anybody have godly grandparents? Amen. That had those kind of stories. And those are important. And so every person, I've got a little assignment for you today, all right? You may want to jot this down. I want you to think of the stories that you want your kids and grandkids to know about.
Yeah.
In your family history.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you might know my story of how God healed Derek, and that's a wonderful thing. But let me tell you something. God wants you to have a story. God wants you to be able to share those things. Those family memories are so important. So go back and review your history with God this week. Take a little time and go out underneath a tree with some lemonade and bring a fan out there so you don't roast to death out there. And just, you know, get comfortable somewhere under the air conditioning. I don't care. But just do something and go out there and think about all that God has done and start writing it down and think to yourself, "I'm going to share this with my family. I'm going to be a vocal person about what God has done in my life, because I want to be part of the generation that declares God's works to the next generation.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. The second thing is, you might think, I don't have any great stories like that, Pastor Bob. Well, ask God to give you and your family powerful stories. Just ask Him. Ask God to give you a great story about His power, that something He did in your life. Some of the greatest memories that I have in my life are sitting around the table at my mother and father-in-law's house. They were very good at telling family stories. The history of their family, the spiritual history. My father-in-law would talk about that, and my mother-in-law would talk about that, and we would hear the story of how, you know, Benny was a farmer, and you know, he just passed away a while back, but he was a farmer for all those years, and, you know, a faithful believer, a faithful giver, a faithful tither. And, you know, down at the cafe, you gotta go, just imagine small town America, okay? Farmers' hats, feed store hats, and, you know, guys that are dirty from being on the tractor, they're in there having coffee, and they would all tease Benny, why are you giving all your money to the church? And on they would go. But what happened was, there was a day when a hailstorm came. This is a true story. A hailstorm came and devastated almost all of Nobles County. I mean, most of the farmers in that area had a total washout on their crops, but not on Benny's property. In fact, you could go right to the fence post and look down the fence post, and the field on that side was devastated, but Benny's crops were completely 100% well. And the farmers would drive into town, and they would pass by Benny's place, and they got to the cafe, and they were saying, Benny, how did you arrange that with the Almighty? What happened there? And Benny would just lift his head up and say, you know what? I pay my tithes, man. God takes care of me. I'm just here today to tell you that those are the kind of stories. And you may not be a farmer, but let me tell you something. Did you not find God giving you a raise? Did you not find God opening up a door? Wasn't God there when you needed Him? I'm just here today to tell you that you've got a story. Ask God for a story. Amen. I dare you to ask God for that. And it's wonderful to know somebody else's story. You can tell Reinhard Bonnke's story or other people's stories, but you need your own stories. That's why the book of James tells us you do not have because you do not ask. Ask God for stories.
That's right.
Ask God for stories.
That's right.
I want you to be aware of something, though. When you ask for stories, most stories about spiritual memories, they come from trials and testings and struggles,
right,
and sometimes even heartaches.
That's right.
You don't have to ask for that. How many of you know those things come anyway?
Yep.
Am I right? Those things happen anyway. So every time you find yourself in a place where, man, you're like, I need God. Here's what you do. You say, God, I need a story.
Yeah.
You help me here. Amen. I need something that I can pass on to the next generation. Take your task and ask God to turn it into a testimony. Take your trial and ask God to turn it into a triumph for Jesus. Take your heartache and ask God to turn it into a heartfelt praise.
Amen.
I love to read the story that's found in the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis, the story of how God works in family lines. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, right? It's so beautiful to read that, and it's many, many chapters long, and it tells the good points and the high points and the low points, and it's just kind of like every family that ever was. There are good days and bad days and famine days and happy days. But you know something, as you read through there, what you see are the blessings of God being transferred from one generation to another in covenant and blessing and promise. And I'm just here today to tell you that what God did in the first book of the Bible was He showed us, listen, I want to move in family lines. I want to move in your kids' lives. I want to move in your grandkids' lives. Why did He do that? Because let me tell you, later on in the word says that God is not a respecter of person.
Right.
Amen. Right? He doesn't have any favorites. Abraham wasn't His favorite. He loved Abraham. Guess what? He loves you too, right? I love Romans 2:11 says, there is no partiality with God. What God will do for others, He will do for you. So ask God for stories. Wouldn't it be great if 2 years from now or 3 years from now, amen, you could just gather with your children and say, you know, I just want to tell you the things the Lord has done in my life. Amen. Write them down. Write them down. Amen. Ask God for stories. And then number three, realize that building family memories